in a group effort. We had more than 100 volunteers, and I would like very much to thank you to all, every volunteer that, you know, put a hole in this wall, come every day, organize, help, or even took the garbage sometimes, because it would, you know. It's very important. It's the only way we can get these things done. I would also like to thank Babby for believing almost before everybody else. You know, was honor. I don't even know how, why she said yes for the first time I asked her. Loren, for letting us borrow these facts and believing from the beginning. No. James, for coming all the time and writing and, you know, believing as well and putting his name now on it. I would love to say thank you to Keith and Michael, who has been, and Rain, your assistant, has been the biggest pleasure. I'm sorry the mess. I'm sorry about the mess. But thank you guys so much. No, it was amazing. You know, I kind of like, I just wished when I was trying to look for a place for the book launch, you know, and Nicole said, like, you know, how about we seeking space together? I was just like, oh, no, I can't do more than that. I just want a little, you know, wall that represents a little bit of the book. And I couldn't even find that during the BOS. Everybody's already booked. And I told Lauren, I told Paul, it was like, it was Friday night. On Monday morning, I got a phone call from Paul. I got your place. And he's going to even give you two walls. And I called Mike, no, I want to give you the whole gallery for, you know, a couple of weeks. I was like, oh, really? It's like, be careful what you wish. So I'd like to thank everybody, you know. I also the Art and Bushwick founders, because I think the spirit we have here was their first idea. Laura, Chloe, and Amy, they're not here, but no, they really helped to get the whole thing together by the end and keep the accounting going. Patricia, for always being a smile and working really fast and get the time accomplished that we could have this year in time, 15 days in advance. Now, like, the panel's here, and we decided in the spirit of Art Bushwick that everybody's going to do this itself, but I just like to say that when I put this, you know, group together, to me, they're visionaries, they're overseeing the future, you know, people that really not just understand history, but also understand the importance of the community, and that's why they're here. Now, I'm going to introduce Lisa Krina-Daves. Is always a believer too. She's, you know, every time I call her and ask something, Lisa, of course, Sibeli. So Lisa's gonna be the moderator. Thank you.
Thank you. Before I let the panelists introduce who they are, I just want to thank Sibeli. And for those of you who have just wandered in here, you might not know what this is about, but this is about this woman and other people in this community who have put together this miraculous book, which someone in the last session called, compared it to Jansen's History of Art. So you can just hold it up, Sibeli, so everyone can see what it looks like. So this is like all done by volunteers in this community that wanted, after 10 years of Bushwick Open Studios, to document what's going on in this community and have made an important contribution in this incredible book to show what has happened in this community in the last 10 years. But this woman is heroic. She never quits. I don't know if she sleeps or eats or has any fun, but she's worked really hard. So I just, everyone should really give a big applause to Sibeli. So let's start to the right. And Loren, would you introduce, say who you are and so everyone knows?
Well, I'm Loren Munk, also known as James Calm. I started studying the Brooklyn art scene probably in the mid-90s, mostly in Williamsburg. About 2003, I was probably one of the first people that came out to Bushwick at that point and started covering what was going on here for the Brooklyn Rail. And starting in about 2006, I've also been producing videos that I post on YouTube on a couple of different channels, and probably a high percentage of that is work for exhibitions and studios and things dealing with Bushwick. And I'm just a big fan of art, but this is my map painting over here that sort of charts a little bit of the art scene. And so I'm very interested in art, real estate, people's lives and time and space, artists' lives.
My name is Cynthia Tobar. I'm a moral historian, a media artist, and an archivist, currently working at Bronx Community College. That's how I pay the bills, and my art is how I express what I see happening in my community day in and day out. I'm a first generation American citizen, and I've been living in New York City basically my whole life. And the rent would go up, my parents would move to a different neighborhood. So I've lived in several neighborhoods. Bushwick is where I've been the longest. And it's been astounding to see the changes happening in the neighborhood and seeing how a lot of this overdevelopment has essentially changed the character and changed access for many people who can't no longer afford to live and make a living doing what they used to do in Bushwick. So it compelled me to do a documentary project, Cities for People, Not for Profit, which has been featured in the book thanks to Sibeli and her faith in the project. Doing interviews, oral history interviews, of not just long-term residents and activists in the community, but also artists, which I believe are a group within this talk of gentrification that tend to be used as scapegoats when we talk about their role in the change in gentrification in neighborhoods in New York City. So it's an online website, and it's taken on a new life, and the perspective of arts, of the artists, the role of the art world are themes that are very important.
I'm Deborah Brown. I'm a painter, and I've had a studio in Bushwick for, I guess, about 10 or 12 years, and started with Jason Andrew, one of the first artist-run galleries here called Storefront, which had different incarnations, which I continued in different spaces, and I'm on the community board in Bushwick, and I've been involved with a number of the not-for-profits in the community, nurture art, Momenta especially, and also with Brick and No Longer Empty and other artists' advocacy groups, and I'm still here and happy to be on this panel.
I'm James Panero. I'm an editor and writer, and I write a monthly gallery chronicle for my magazine, New Criterion. And it's been great assigning, because I'm my own signing editor, and therefore I just started assigning myself writing about Bushwick. And I just started doing it more and more, and I couldn't prevent it. I just loved writing about what was happening out here. I found it so exciting, so refreshing, a refreshing alternative to the mainstream, which is a little bit what we're going to talk about today. And as part of that, most recently, I've worked with the photographer Mel Meisler on an exhibition right now called Bushwick Chronicle that is about documenting the neighborhood in photographs and writing.
And I'm Lisa Corinne Davis. I'm a painter and a professor at Hunter College, and there's Hunter College people here because I think they're interested about community and how to do what they're going to do. I've been working in Bushwick for about 7 years and came here because I couldn't afford other neighborhoods and other studios, so I'm sure that will fold into the conversation about real estate and gentrification in places like Bushwick. But the title of this panel is Making History Outside the Mainstream Art World. So I'm not sure that any artist or writer or gallerist thinks about, when they're doing what they do, making history. I think they think about terms of doing relevant and important work. But since we are kind of in conversation here with the mainstream, I thought with James, because you write about everything, and what is the mainstream in your mind?
The mainstream. I'm glad I didn't have a warning about this question, because I probably would have a less interesting answer. But I thought immediately Chelsea's the mainstream. But that's not even quite right to say it's a location is the mainstream. Because what is the mainstream? It's a current. It's a main current. It's a flow. And so it's everything involved in that flow and what's outside of that flow. So what's involved in that flow? Well, it's kind of, it's big name galleries, mega galleries. It is Chelsea in part, but not all of Chelsea. It's the celebrity culture. It's what gets covered. It's what, if I went to someone and said, you know, I write about art, and they say, well, who do you write about? And I'll give them some names. And, and they'll hear it, they know those people or they don't, you know, and that's kind of what the mainstream is. Do they know what you're talking about if you just follow someone off the street, or do you really have to kind of introduce them into something different than what they're familiar with?
So do you see that artists function differently in that realm than the our exhibitions from Chelsea, if we use that as an idea, to Bushwick?
I think there, it's entirely different. There's so much more freedom when you're outside the mainstream. There's more money if you're in the mainstream, obviously. But there's more freedom to do what you want to do if you're outside of it, because you don't have to pay the rent. You don't have to pay all these other charges to have your mega gallery. You know, I think that New York City in general has entered into a kind of dumbbell economy, where there's a very rich and a very poor. And, you know, I think Bushwick has been the very poor part of it, and in a way has evolved, just as Chelsea has evolved into a very rich gallery setting. This has evolved into the opposite, and both can survive while the middle ground gets cleared out.
So Deborah, you recently said, Bushwick Open Studios' earliest incarnations was produced by community activists and artists who saw utopian possibility for artists to reject the art cliches of Manhattan's elites and create a less hierarchical alternative. Want to say more about that?
I think that when the scene was smaller, that was the ethos, and there were people involved in the foundation of Bushwick Open Studios who weren't even really artists. They were more interested in community, and I think they set the ground rules for how this community has evolved and the spirit that still is present, but and that was to say everybody can play and nobody's that much better than anybody else as an artist, and it's about participation and transparency, and I think that made it hard for people to come here and establish the kind of cliques and hierarchies that exist in the Manhattan art world that we all know really well, those of us who have dipped our toe into that. And that's been, I think, spearheaded by Bushwick Open Studios. But other people who've introduced other kinds of activities in Bushwick as an art community have had to sort of follow along with that as the guiding principle. And I think that's been really wonderful.
But you say you think this is disappearing.
I think this community is just changed a lot. Obviously, the landscape has changed a lot. There's so many more artists here. And I think that in our wake, we've, of course, as Cynthia was alluding to, created a climate that's very favorable for all kinds of commercial activities and branding to take place that did not have a place here 12 years ago. Those of us who remember what it was like know it was a very different landscape, and that has fragmented the community. There's just sheer numbers of artists, and I think the hoopla that took place, and also by Bushwick Open Studios, and pulling away, making the decision to pull away from all the parties and thong riding around on unicycles, and now all the crazy stuff that used to take place here as kind of a celebration, but also an excess. It's not clear actually what this community is to me now. I'm not sure. It's still very much about artists, but I don't think the cohesiveness could exist that it did in the early days because it's so much bigger. So, and it's also been, I think, branded and diluted by this envelope of commercialism. Mm-hmm. So I don't really know what I think about it. I'd be interested to know what others, how other people feel.
Well, I mean, this is not a new story, right? I mean, we watched this happen in Lauren, you were saying Soho, and then the Lower East Side, and Williamsburg, and so. Yeah, so I mean, I'm curious from the two of you, like, how can the origins of like a lived community survive the entrance of an artist community, and then have all that initial idea of forming something where artists can collect and talk and not be polluted by money? How can that train stop and also not destroy the community that the artists originally? Do you have an idea about that?
Yeah.
Okay, I mean, I think it's important to note too that the artistic community has also existed before the influx of what mainstream media talks about. All the artists have come in. There've already been a rich artistic community in the neighborhood. In addition to that, when you have predominantly white artists coming into a neighborhood, I think that the tensions start to happened in regards to the way that people conscientiously enter a community. And so I think that that has a lot to do with that. A lot of the art that I'm participating in tends to be very socially engaged, and so it tends to take a very community-based collaborative approach, and I feel that that is one way that as an artist, you could take acknowledgement of that, whether you're white, you're black, you're Hispanic, or what have you, to acknowledge that you don't exist in a vacuum, that this is a community that has resources that they're willing to share with you. And by emphasizing that inclusivity that a lot of folks talked about in the previous panel, like with Arts in Bushwick and what people have attempted to do with that, I think that that's also a key way to address those types of inequities that inevitably happen when you have outsiders coming in and being branded, as Deborah was alluding to, as like the hot new thing. And if making peace with those terms and creating a community rather than having it be this forebearer to what gentrification stands for in regards to art galleries like Lurie Augustine down the block, the Chelsea mainstream art world infiltrating into what was once a very creative and freer culture and trying to resist those urges of capitalistic behaviors that tend to like make the community less open and less free and less inclusive. Mm-hmm. Lauren?
Well, thinking about one of your opening statements where you said a lot of artists go in and they just start making work and they don't think about history and things like that. Well, I did that for 20 some odd years. And then as I started to look at what it meant to be an artist and what it meant to be part of a community, I realized history is really, that's all that's left. I mean, in certain ways, that ends up being the truth. You know? So, I think what's ended up happening, as you said, it's gone through cycles. It's been perfected and it's changing a little bit and morphing here and there. But what ends up happening in a community like this is that you get the initial group of people that come in there and they're working and they're hard, sacrificing a lot and doing a lot of things, and everybody's very community oriented. And then when history starts to pay attention to them, and they start to realize that. I was in California a couple of years ago, like 5 or 6 years ago, and I'm sitting there at a cafe having a cup of coffee, and I see some hipster walking by, and he's got a little t-shirt on that says Bushwick. And I'm thinking to myself, somebody in LA, they probably not, or maybe they have, but I'm thinking now it's like Bushwick is a place that you can put on a t-shirt and walk around, and people go, oh, that's like really, really hip stuff. So in a way, everybody comes here and they're doing their thing and they want to be individuals and part of a community and all this other stuff and sort of say, oh, the historic thing or the commercial thing, all that. We're not worried about that. On the other hand, when that recognition does start to come, nobody's going to turn around and go, oh, no, forget about us. No, we don't want to be part of history. We don't want to make money. We don't want to be wealthy, famous artists. And of course, most people in the art world would love to be recognized and would love to have people appreciate what they're doing. On the other hand, you sort of also look and see just historically what has been left in the wake of places like Soho, the East Village, Chelsea. So in a certain way, the artists have got, a couple of different forces that are sort of tearing them apart. And in certain ways, it's kind of a sign of maturity for an art scene when it's like a kid starts to grow up, and certainly when you start to become an adult, you realize I'm an individual, it's no longer my parents or not gonna control this or that. So in certain ways, I think Bushwick has kind of matured and now it's become its own thing. But then that's the question, it's like, well, which way is it gonna go? And that's kind of one of the questions I think we're all kind of confronting here in relationship to history and the mainstream art world.
So is that the impetus behind your painting?
Well, no.
I mean, you're documenting that history in those paintings.
It is,
right?
In certain ways, what I don't like, I kind of start these paintings and I have an idea and I just want to put down the names and try to put a little history there so that people, in certain ways, it's like the book. It's like the book where you have a documentation and it's got people's names and pictures and little stories and maybe even some things about what makes up an art community. But I often say that also there is no such thing as the real, I mean, this is a joke about history. There's no true history. It's all history is somebody's version or somebody else's version or a couple of people's versions. And then it's sort of a consensus that, okay, we agree on this. And this goes back to what the mainstream art world is all about. And that's why Bushwick is so important, because this is a place where you can actually go out and be part of creating a different history, or a history that is true to you and that you will be a part of, rather than letting somebody else decide who gets to be in the history books, who gets to be important, who gets to be in the museums. We get to do that, or try to do that for ourselves.
So, in writing, just thought it was me, that's all. In writing, do you feel when you're writing from, you know, the mainstream to Bushwick, and you said you prefer, you've been doing a lot of writing about exhibitions in Brooklyn, and do you feel a responsibility to not only review the work, but to try to contextualize the differences with what's happening with work in these communities that's different or not?
Well, I feel like I'm providing an important service to our history, because I've really felt that these galleries, these artists out here were not properly being written about. You know, when I think about, New York City real estate now is so valuable that gentrification is almost an inevitability. I think artists are a kind of necessary inconvenience in terms of for the developers, and it's going to happen. The question is, how long can it be slowed down? How much can artists and a community get out of it before that happens? I have to say, I think compared to, let's say, Soho, the development there, I think artists have actually, will end up worse off in Bushwick than they were even in Soho, where they, at least in Soho, were able to buy in and buy their co-ops, and were able to stay longer because of that. I think artists are going to get pushed out of here almost as quickly as they were pushed out of Williamsburg, and it's only a little slower because Williamsburg had a rezoning that accelerated further that redevelopment. But it's just a matter of time, the clock's ticking, and so, you know, that's New York for you, and the question is how much can artists get out of it before we push to the next, before artists are pushed on.
I mean, what kind of history do you think you all have tried to make in this community that's maybe different? I mean, is there something for specific that, I mean, I know, Deborah, that you had a storefront gallery for years where it's tiny space, and my memory of first going there was not only artists, and artists I didn't really know, but the kids on the block, you know, and people were always on the street, and so I think that your push to make it a kind of a community event, and also the push that has happened with the galleries in this area of not being art historically dealer run, but the artist run, it says a statement about control, because, you know, about who's controlling the narrative here. So I'm curious, like, how, you know, in your focus on Bushwick, how all of you hope this kind of history of, you know, gentrification, artists being thrown out, community, how you hope that script would be slightly rewritten or changed.
Well, those are very articulate, that's an articulate summary, I think, of some of the goals of some of us. I feel like for me it's a looking back, because I don't know how to look forward in this landscape. I think it's just very complicated, but I remember my impulse being to treat artists with dignity and respect and give them a showcase that allowed them to put their best foot forward. So it wasn't about tacking up things in a haphazard way or presenting things in a way that was provisional. It was about trying, in a sense, to replicate the sort of purity of art exhibits in the capitalist-driven world, but run by an artist and with no money intentions, no commercial intentions involved. So it was kind of like the best of the art world that we all, I suppose, aspire to in some ways in our dreams, but run by an artist who is not pressuring you to make X work or Y work or whatever. So it was, I think it was very pure, actually. I think it was a really cool idea, and I think other people took that on in their different gallery spaces, and they reflected their taste and their friends and what artwork they thought was valuable to show that maybe wasn't getting an audience, and I think it really worked really well for a while. And there were many flowers blooming in this dialogue, but going forward, I don't feel I have that place in this community now, and that I said what I had to say. So as an individual who participated, I think I had my run. And I think actually artist-run spaces are by necessity fixed in time, partly because of the things that Loren was talking about. All of us wear two hats. We all want to be successful on our own as artists, and we want to be part of a community. And we come from a community, and that's in some ways what allows us to be successful, I think, as artists, having confidence in our own work and our own eye, and being rooted in a community and coming from somewhere. And I think it's a wonderful legacy that those of us who participated in this community at Bushwick have, that we wear those hats. But now this community has all the really big Manhattan artists here. They all have studios here on my block in East Williamsburg. There's Rasheed Johnson, Angel Otero is around the corner. It's like a Hausernworth ghetto. And we have the most successful artists in New York are in our places now, and they're going to be pushing you out. So the community has changed completely from when we used to go around with cars, Jason and you and me, and we'd drive our friends around to try and get them to see these artist-run spaces. That just does not exist anymore. So it's hard to be a champion in the same way for this community, and I certainly cannot be anymore. But it doesn't mean that I don't love the people I showed, and I valued what we did, and totally believed in it. But to do that now in the face of all this backlash against gentrification also, I think, means that you would be a very compromised individual having blinders on about that. So that's another issue going on about different things. But I feel all of those things at the same time. Pride in the past, but also horror at what we've unleashed. I mean, we have unleashed it too. I'm on the community board in Bushwick. Bushwick community board never used to talk about young white artists coming into the neighborhood or gentrifiers or anything. Never, never, never. You were not on their radar. They couldn't have, you were not in their vision. Now, every other word is their house, their hair is on fire, you know, and for good reason. And there's a big backlash. So it's really tough having the same rah-rah about the whole scene. Even in retrospect, it feels a little bit like we were trampling on the future. So that's enough of it.
I think that there's a lot of potential for artists to tap into the power that their art can have in situations outside of just promoting and sustaining their own art making. And I feel that in times as dire as these, it's really important to make those connections with resources in the community that already exist, with activist circles that already exist that are trying to affect this, because it's not something that's just affecting artists. We are part of a whole. And the moment that as artists we think outside of the scope of just what affects just the art world and just our circles, I feel that there is a lot of potential for that. Some of the projects and some of the artists that have inspired me, such as Betty Yu, who's been doing a lot of wonderful work talking about fighting against gentrification in Chinatown, for instance, in Manhattan, that has dealt with its own fair share of housing violations and whatnot compared to what Bushwick residents have been facing here. It's astronomical, but the fight continues, and I think that it's gotta be that fire in your belly, and Bushwick historically has this legacy of fighting back times much worse than these. When we think about the 70s and the 60s and the 80s, talking about arson, talking about making beauty out of garbage, that's a very powerful component in this neighborhood. This neighborhood has that history. It's been documented, and it can happen again if people are properly motivated outside of just their own self-serving needs. Not to let artists are thinking about themselves in a self-serving way, but we are part of a whole. And it's tapping into that that I think will lead to a lot more potential for change. And I see that happening already in different circles in different areas throughout the city, talking about some wonderful art protests, movements about public statues and commemoration and actions and the role of public art and how that can change not just the perspective of people locally within your neighborhood, but the people within the neighborhood and the constituencies and the politics that have the power to make change that will affect everyone, including artists. Mm-hmm. So,
well, on one of the earlier panels, they were talking about artists in certain certain ways have become a scapegoat. And because for the last 25 or 30 years, I've been spending a lot of time sort of studying how communities form and how certain groups of artists or whatever sort of become a core and things start to happen around there. So if you're a part of that art world and you come from studying art history like that, you get this feeling that, oh, the artists are the ones that are powerful, this and that, and they do this, and they, where they can make, they can change this and that. Okay, maybe a little bit. I was at a meeting, was dealing with artist housing a couple of years ago. I think Patty Johnson organized it, and they had a community person from the mayor's office was there, and they're talking about gentrification and a lot of other things, and she stood up and she said, my mother used to work in those buildings that became artist lofts. And then she sat down, and everybody's sort of there going, you know, I mean, okay, mostly a group of white artist types, and they're all sort of like, oh, I feel so bad, the artist pushed your poor mom out of the job. Unfortunately, I wanted to jump up and go, this is a bunch of crap. Because, and this is not, this doesn't necessarily deal with Bushwick, but what it's really about is it was about Soho. It wasn't that the artists pushed those people out. Economics pushed those people out. The unions, Robert Moses, a whole lot of people, and World War II, and people wanted to live in the suburbs. All those people that ran those businesses said, we're going broke, we can't keep these things, well, we're going to leave. And so they basically had what they ended up calling Hell's 100 Acres. They had a huge swath of downtown Manhattan that was just empty, huge buildings. Nobody would go in there. Nobody. This woman's, the people who were employing this woman's mother, they didn't want to be there, but it wasn't the artists that pushed them out and said, we're going to have our luxury lofts here. The economy just said, this is not viable for what it's done. It's going down the tubes. Nobody's going to spend the money to take care of it. People are, you know, they're starting fires. People are getting killed. Fire officers are getting killed. So then it was sort of like, because that place was such a rotten pit and a and you're talking about beauty out of crap, people like George McCunis, the guy that started Fluxus, looked at this and said, we got a problem, you know. We got a bunch of rotten buildings. Nobody wants to live here. At one point, Robert Moses wanted to tear out the whole place and put in a huge highway that would go straight from the Holland Tunnel to the Williamsburg Bridge, and they wanted to wipe that whole thing out. Anyway, being creative, he looked at that problem and he said, you got a bunch of empty buildings, it's going down the tubes, people are dying on fire. What would be a creative way that we could solve these problems? And he said, oh, my friends are artists. Everybody wants to have a large studio because it was the days of abstract expressionism or minimalism, they need a lot of space. Hey, we can get these artists in there. So slowly but surely he started buying one building after another, getting artists in there. And you know, within about a 20-year period, turned into Soho. Okay, so that's its own little historical thing. My point is that artists are only a part of the gentrification program. If every artist in this community disappeared tomorrow, it would only change the gentrification thing slightly. And the gentrification is still going to be moving on, it's still going to be happening. So as I see it, the problem is for artists and just people in general, is to look at what's going on and saying, this is the way it goes. And so maybe if you're smart and if you've got some creativity and imagination, you figure out how you can somehow, and it's not going to be forever, but for a while, you're going to be able to pitch your tent, have your little lifestyle, do what you need to do without being pushed out somewhere that you're at the other end of the culture that you belong to. So that's what I think is, people have to get to be a lot more creative, and when you start talking about working with communities and stuff like that, that's where a lot of the creativity
comes. Or even artist collectives, like Silent Barn, is a very popular example. It's just this whole idea of that they've been featured in the Times so many times, how many people have read those wonderful articles documenting people's attempts at collective living in a house. So it's, people are starting to find
rooftop gardening.
Yeah, it's like, okay, but applying that on a much larger scale, I think there's a lot of potential for that. if people put their heads together and really start to think.
But I don't think that you can like point the finger and say those damn, you know, those Yale graduates or Columbia or those SBA grad, those hipsters are the ones that are doing it, because you're just making a scapegoat. Because people are, you know, they're going to go somewhere, the developers are going to go somewhere, and so basically what you want to do is figure out how you can sort of deal creatively with this without burning down the neighborhood or doing something bad.
Well, with Cities for People, Not for Profit, I've been collecting the stories of artists and local residents, and the hope is that by collecting all these stories, it'll open a space for dialogue, and people will start to understand not just the dissimilarities, but the vast similarities.
But you want experimentation and stuff, and a lot of things happening, so people can sort of go, well, gee, they did this and this, and that worked. And
precisely. And I mean, I think dialogues and venues such as these are also very helpful, so that if at least maybe the light goes off, or maybe a few people even sitting in this room thinking about it, like, oh, I can think creatively with my neighbor down the street about how maybe perhaps we want to open up our homes or our street, or maybe I can be more involved in the community board meetings, or maybe I can start thinking of maybe making relationships with key people in the neighborhood who have this local power, how you can think act globally by acting locally.
None of those things forestalls the trading of real estate, which changes the composition of communities. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're all talking about these kinds of activities as if we're operating outside capitalism, and I think that's kind of what comes back to what you were saying, mm-hmm. is that, and you do, that it's only temporary. I mean,
well, unless you start to learn how to deal with capitalism in a capitalistic way, which might be the ultimate creative act.
I don't know too many people who are able to do that, though, in
that's
real estate.
That's exactly
market.
Right. Well,
what you're talking about in the 70s was because nobody wanted those buildings, and nobody
yes.
wanted the buildings in Bushwick when I came here either.
No, that's exactly right. And the other side to that,
undervalued things, artists always get there first. They get, and they're probably getting to those neighborhoods that exist now in New York that are affordable. But
that's
it's only temporary. And so what you're talking about is creative activities are. Like, unless you control your real estate, you're going to be forced to take your show on the road.
Well, nobody actually ever controls it. I mean, you've got a certain period of time. You live, you die. And if you can hang on to a piece of ground for that time, okay, that's cool. But it's not going to be, like, forever. It's just, we're all kind of, pilgrims on this quest. Like I said, you pitch your tent for a while, and if you can stay there for a long time, so much better. If you can't, well, you better figure out a creative way to keep going.
But I mean, the city is not going to protect artists. The city is not.
No,
going to protect,
and this is what I was going to say is that
as
it's
a protected class, they're worried more about other categories of individuals who are
yes,
in need
have more money,
and,
yeah.
or less money.
Well,
both.
But Soho was not only unique in that the artists were very fortunate to be able to get in there and. Somebody like George McCunis was a visionary and was able to say, let's do this, and everybody else at that point was going, that's the stupidest thing anybody ever came up with. He was able to come up with that idea, and it actually ended up working. On the other hand, you had city planners, developers, and all these other people looking at it, and they're taking notes too, and they're saying, oh, we're going to make sure these people never get a chance to do that again. So in a lot of ways, you have to be playing both sides of the card, because these people have gotten the developers, the city planners, and they're working on this just as hard, maybe harder. It's like Fong Gui always used to say something like, you can always, or something, whenever you're dealing with evil, remember, they're always better organized.
No, I agree with that. The city is not going to protect its artists as a class the way it did in the past. You're not going to have an extension of artists in residence and artists zoning protections the way you had in Soho. That's just never going to happen. If anything, they're going to try to push the artists out as quickly as possible.
Well, they want to push them to a new place that they can then use them as a block breakers or whatever to drive the
I don't think the city has any idea about this. They are so behind this. It's the boots on the ground are the people
the developers.
Who, and but they're following way later. I mean, anybody who was here a while ago knows that there were no developers here 12 years ago, and there were no bars, and there were no restaurants, and there were no vintage stores, and it was a pretty desolate landscape in a lot of ways.
So I guess I would like to bring this back to, okay, because the real estate problem is a huge one that we're not going to solve here. But I'm just curious, like, what it definitely busts up some need that artists have for community. Like, artists have always made history outside of the mainstream. When history happens, it's because a bunch of artists have stepped aside from whatever the current thing that's happening then. And there seems to be some disruption that happens when it goes from a small community. So talking about back in the day when Deborah first came here and established her storefront, it was a small community. And I remember when I first moved here, I loved the fact that I could go to the one coffee shop and see everyone in the neighborhood and talk about shows and talk about whatever. So I'm just kind of curious, like, what makes it hard to create anything that has a kind of historical texture to it once the community gets too big or displaced by real estate issues? Because, I mean, James, you were talking about the you know, how in Soho at a certain time, like, that group kind of like came up with, you know, minimalism was like the conversation, right? So what happens, and what has the conversation that's erupted out of Bushwick at this point? Like, what has made it, as it seems to be going to the dark side, like, having some conversation that's particular to this time period? And I would suggest, as a possibility, again, the main one is the artist-run gallery. Like, what the notion behind artists, Deborah, you're an artist, running a gallery is, and this real need to, in many cases, still be conversant with the neighborhood. So I think that's what has made Bushwick kind of special to this point, but why can't we continue that? Forgetting real estate, like, what happens, you know, to an artist population when it gets too big, you know, because I think that's it, it's just getting too big. Would you say it's getting too big?
I think it's too big, and also I think artists run out of gas running galleries, because if there is, Loren, you were saying, if you're really interested in your own work, you have ambitions for your own work, you've always done your own work, it's hard to do that, and the lines get confused, and you start being thought of as a gallerist, but you really want to keep being an artist, and I think, for me, that was certainly part of it, and I think I don't know if this is part of it, but this is like a hunch, that maybe the original people in a community or self-appointed originals want to sort of hold on to that mantle, and when it gets too big, they feel like, I don't know if I recognize myself here, or like you were saying, you used to go off down the street, you knew everybody,
yeah.
That is not true anymore, and so you feel a little bit alienated from this place that you've started, quote unquote, you've started it. So I think it's a little bit of self-aggrandizement and then alienation from the force that you've unleashed that's made something so big that you no longer recognize your own place in it. And I would say that's my own story. I don't know whether that's other people's stories.
Well, I'd also just like to get the writer's point. I keep going to the writer. Okay. So, it just from the observation, because Deborah's in it. She's like the painter, you know, but like, just from like what you see, do you see this notion of community and not?
Well, I think it's a question of what is going to be the legacy of Bushwick. You know, there isn't a particular Bushwick style. That's what makes always interested me. Mm-hmm. If you look around this room, there's many different styles of work. I think it is this DIY quality. That the alternative system that Bushwick has put in place, one that draws on the community, one that draws on the finding beauty out of the neighborhood, that I think is what's going to translate and evolve and become what Bushwick is known for, as opposed to just minimalism. There's not a style of minimalism or cubism that we can say, well, that's what came out of that neighborhood.
And before it becomes commodified, right?
That's
for
right.
For real estate needs, but let's not
talk
about that.
Well, I think it's artists taking charge, and I think as some of you know, we curated a show on the Boar's Head property. You know, Boar's Head is this huge community employer. They've been here 100 years, and got the idea to do an outdoor sculpture show on their street. Like, could you imagine doing that in Manhattan, where first of all, a company would own a whole street, a whole city block, where they would let you do something as an art event on their property? Like, how amazing is that? And I remember thinking, that's really the spirit of what it is to be an artist here, that you could engage like a local business that has property and do something that is completely open to the public. It's open, like, they open their street to us to put art on it, and people could wander around. Like, that's really, like, take charge, like, do something that is, like, very bold and ambitious and engages the community and is open to the public. And artists did things like that. And
yeah,
galleries were part of that, and like, it was just a really exciting feeling that you could do anything out here. You certainly can't do that in the more established Manhattan gallery system.
And I think there's a lot of potential for collaboration with local businesses that are struggling to exist and are also under that pendulum of, like, how much longer can we survive here? And I think that there's a lot of potential for artists to capitalize on that and say, let's join forces and let's create a solution together. How can our art making help your local business survive, and how can we work together? And I think that there have been a lot of initiatives in the city that have been very successful in providing examples of that. The Laundromat Project is a very popular one, and other types of initiatives such as More Art and other initiatives to just get artists to bridge that divide with, again, the community that already exists right down the street, the things that might very well be displaced by the dirt art galleries from these successful artists that are pushing things away. There is a lot of potential there.
Well, I think one of the things that Deborah said is kind of interesting, that, you know, it's like we've gone through this period and now it's different. And I don't know, I'm probably the oldest person on the panel up here, so I've been looking at the New York art scene since 1970. And so I've seen this happen at various times. I wrote a piece for the Brooklyn Rail, and I was talking about a guy named Ward Shelley. Ward Shelley did a beautiful Williamsburg timeline, and he's got it broken down into sections. And our work sort of goes together, so I'm a big fan of his work. So he's got one section, it's like, I don't know, it was 1993 to 1995, and it's like the golden age, you know, and that's when Williamsburg really was doing this great stuff, and they were having these raves in these pier front warehouses, and they had the mustard factory, and they had all these other things. But he said this was at 1993 to 1995 or 96, whatever. And he's like, that's the golden age. So I'm talking to this with a young gallerist, Daniel Acock, who's now an old gallerist. I think he finished this in 2004. And so Daniel's looking at that, and he's going, what's this crap? He says that, you know, 1993 to 96 was the golden age. No, that's wrong. Now is the golden age. So in a certain way, Deborah, you and maybe mine and some other people, our experiences of what Williamsburg or what Bushwick is now might be different than it was 5 or 6 years ago. But there are lots of young people, maybe not so young people, that are coming here, and they're having their golden age. So in a certain way, all of these various highlights, you know, parts of your life that you can look back and go on, that was the golden age, that only relates to you. So what's happening now is what's been happening all along, and all you can hope for is that you extend your own personal golden age as long as you can, you know, until they
time to open up to questions or discussion from the audience or Patrick.
I just need to respond to that, because I think that points to the problem that Deborah was getting at when she was saying that, like, you know, we have this moment and we get away from it because, like, you're because of the self-aggrandizement. The self-aggrandizement.
Yeah. Actually, could you stand up? Sorry.
And project.
The problem that Deborah was speaking to, I think, pushes back at what Loren was saying, and that she was talking about self-aggrandizement and extending self-aggrandizement, like, doesn't really, or extending your golden age doesn't get you anywhere. Perhaps what we're actually talking about in terms of community is divesting or experiencing the myriad form of golden ages happening simultaneously and, like, one after another, which is what you've done over the past 3 years. So, like, I don't understand why you're pushing for this, like, the individual, when, like...
Well, first of all, we can only experience the world as an individual. I can't go out and say, well, I feel... I am the spirit of Bushwick, so I feel everything that the Bushwick people should have felt. That would be an illusion. The other thing that I'm saying is that being part of a golden age doesn't mean that it's all focused on you. The golden age might be the time that it's like the rock and roll bands, like, yeah, man, when we were together and we were playing this, you know, it was fantastic. And so your golden age might be getting, like, the people at Arts in Bushwick, they spent 10 years doing this, and it's gotten better and better and better, and they keep working on it. And so for them, that's their golden age. It wasn't it's like, well, I only did this for myself and this and that. So I think having your golden age, in certain ways, it wouldn't even be a golden age if you didn't have people to share it with. And so I don't think that there's like a distinction between having a golden age and like hogging up everything for yourself. Because in certain ways, I think, like I said, being part of the golden, you've got to have other people that you share this with, that you're working with, you're sacrificing for, you're paying attention to these people, you're caring about that stuff. And that, to me, that kind of feeling is going to help your golden age, if you want to call it that.
Thanks for all your comments. I was hearing two things, one in relationship to real estate and capitalism, and the other in relationship to social cohesion. And so this is my first time participating in this event, and so I was really interested in the social cohesion part of it and what you're getting at. And if you talk a little bit more about that, aspect of things, because you use the example of Soho almost being destroyed by Robert Moses. The reason why it wasn't destroyed was people like Jane Jacobs and community, so social cohesion. And so the other comment I had about, if you can talk more about your perspective, this notion of like not being able to move from one node to another place, I think we need to get over that, because the creative destruction of capitalism moves people out into, everybody gets moved. So I just feel like if there's an imagination about like why we're so stuck to one place, and that moving out or moving somewhere else or going upstate, or, you know, it's something world. And so this notion of social cohesion is really interesting to me, and I'm really excited that the group decided to go in that direction, to reintegrate rather than go the capitalist direction. And if you can speak a little bit more about that.
Sure. I mean, in regards to like examples of some ways that I've applied it in my own work, with the Cities for People Not-for-Profit project, the ultimate aim is to go out and educate the public, and not just about the situation, about how it's dealt with and how artists have been scapegoats in these conversations, but then also bring to light and say they're also facing displacement. And it's not that we're anti-art, we're just anti-displacement. As Ben Yu has said in her talks about gentrification and ways that we can meld these topics and catalyze them towards more action. And I feel that that happens through performance and dialogue. It's that the hope is that once these stories are collected, we can have events at venues with other groups that are also documenting gentrification and its role in their lives within the community. And it could be something that could be done in an open dialogue. I mean, that's the ultimate hope. Currently, I have a show at Silent Barn that's dealing with these issues as they pertain not just to artists and activists, but to public housing residents, which is now another side of the argument that people, another segment of the population that's been terribly overlooked, because they're the bastions of the last bits of affordable housing that exist in the city. But gentrification is affecting them as well, because the cost of living is skyrocketed as a result of the gentrification that's been brought on by the redevelopment that was perhaps preceded by the scapegoat of the art world. So it's like, we need this room not just to have the dialogue, but through the dialogue is how ideas and solutions are crystallized. And we need that interaction, not just amongst ourselves where you're kind of just preaching to the choir, but with legislators and city council people, so that we can start implementing some change and they can start to see that their decisions have consequences on the living conditions of all people in the city. And we're not going to take it anymore. You got to get angry. You got to get involved. That's the only way.
Can I speak to that? You know, I'm glad you brought up the fact that there are many great creative communities in this country. And it's very egocentric of us to think, you know, it's where we are and we're the golden age. I write about Detroit, you know, I write about Philadelphia. I mean, there are great scenes everywhere. I think the concern, though, is that, you know, Bushwick does have something special going for it. It really did, has and did. I think it has to do with the density of artists here. the organizational spirit of the community itself, and that can't just be replicated anywhere you go. And so I do think there's really something to be said for trying to hold on as long as possible and not just getting, well, there I go, that's over, on to the next place.
Yeah.
I wanted to say that this says, I know I've been very vociferous today, but this could be subtitled Making History, Artists Who Care About What They Do. Because what you were saying about it existing in other places, if you take a community of artists that care about what they do, they can't exist anywhere. And I think what happened in this particular case is that Bushwick did make history, but it made history not just for the past, but for moving forward, because it empowered artists. It gave a lot of artists the idea that they could do this in other places, they could create communities. I have a place in Florida, and it is the grassroots. I'm recently been invited to participate in the first annual West Palm Beach show. And it's an interesting thing because they are trying out what people have done in other places. And what they want to know is, can we survive as an artist group if we band together? So what they want is something like the model that has been created here. And I think that what is important about the history that we have made here is that we create a model. It's not that Bushwick is so great, and it's not any offense to anybody who's always lived in Bushwick as their community, but I've lived in many different places in Brooklyn over the last 36 years, and every time an artist moves into a place, it becomes the place. It's not that the real estate is great, it's that the artists are great, and the artists bring the things other people want because people admire creativity. So wherever artists go, that's where the real estate is gonna go. There aren't great houses here. There was a whole block down Tompkins. In the 7 years that I lived on Flushing Avenue, nobody wanted to live on Tompkins. And now Tompkins, you probably can't touch the real estate. And it's probably just because artists came here. So if artists go somewhere else, the real estate is gonna go there. And if artists move out, then also the real estate is not gonna be worth as much. So what's important is not where you live, but what you do and what you make of it, and how much you care about the other people who do what you do.
I feel like this is like a dumb statement, but you know, there is something about putting down roots in a community. I mean, I don't think they're easy to dig up when you put them down. So yes, artists can move. I mean, we all have, you know, but you know, when you put your roots down, it's like you are creating the studio next door, the coffee shop across the street, the guy that, you know, snow.
But your roots are not your place.
Well,
they're
I'm just saying
people.
That it's like that's the stuff that feeds what we do in the studio and keeps the conversation going. And I do think it's really disruptive for artists to have to dig it all up and recreate it elsewhere.
Is. It's terrible.
So I just, you know, I did this like kind of base statement, but I don't think it's so easy. I think that's the sadness, if I could speak for Deborah, that she feels
is
slipping a bit, you know.
Well, it's not a happy thing. I recently moved from my Flushing Avenue apartment to Albany and to West Palm Beach because I couldn't afford it here anymore. And I came back for this because all of you were important to me. So I wanted to be part of this dialogue, but that doesn't mean that I can't take the dialogue somewhere else and create that magic somewhere else. And I think that, yes, it's sad, but throughout history, artists have always sort of been pushed to their limits. They come in, they make a place great, they leave. Sometimes they leave it better, sometimes they leave it worse. Now, Soho, when I moved to Manhattan, Soho was artists. All my teachers lived in Soho. And they all built all those buildings, and now it's Victoria's Secret. And I don't know that artists really care about living there so much.
I just like to say something also about this. I think that we all have a sense of entitlement as artists where we don't take advantage of the systems that are put down in front of us when they happen. For example, in Soho, you can go through Soho and you can see a number of artists who still live there
it, though. That, you know, we're talking, it's one thing for artists who've lived somewhere for 10 years or something to have to move and where there are other artists. When you talk about a community that's been here for a long time, it's less easy for them to pick up and leave. They have neighbors that they've known for 50 years. They have Aunt Sally down the street. They have, you know, it's not so easy for them to pick up and remake and make a new community. It just isn't. And
yeah,
I think,
and
by the way, there are beautiful houses here. I live off the Halsiel. There are gorgeous, gorgeous brownstones there that are absolutely stunning, and they've been stunning for decades. I mean, you know, Bushwick is vast. It's not just Morgan Avenue, Jefferson, and Broadway Myrtle or Central. There's a vast part of Bushwick that many of us don't get to and don't see and don't experience. And it would be us, it's all good to be a little less myopic
sure.
about that.
And I would say that, like, that's part of the work, because even on the block where my studio is, there's people across the street that have lived there for 25 years. They're fearful. You know, the guy who's driving his pickup truck in a certain spot, you know, there's like an awkward conversation. Didn't realize that he has his own interest in art that has nothing to do with what any of us do, and it's quite interesting. So it does, so thank you for bringing up that longer history that lives there. You were going to say something?
Well, I was going to say, I mean, we do have such a flourishing artistic community here in Bushwick. It's not something you can just transplant. And I think more than that, back to that first question of what's the mainstream. You know, for me, this is my mainstream. This is what I care about. And I think it goes to Loren's point that we are our own art history. There's a self-identification component here that Bushwick, I think, has been forceful enough and can make that claim. And that can't just be transplanted elsewhere.
But not everybody can live in New York, and a lot of people, like I've had a lot of student groups come through my space when I ran it as a gallery, and I thought the most exciting takeaway that I could say was not everybody's going to come here and be able to afford to try and get a toehold here, but you can create art community wherever you are, and you should. Like, don't leave it to other people to do it. You can band together and make these exciting institutions and events happen and outreach to your other neighbors and do it yourself. Go do it. I mean, the world is there. Go for it.
Yeah.
I have a question with regards to the Bush. Oh,
no. He's next. No, I'm just. There's someone's acting out back there. So.
Okay. I wasn't sure.
Gallery's
I had Mike in here.
He's just stretching.
I have a question with regards to what defines the Bushwick art scene, because I think that's just been sort of tossed around and not really defined. And maybe this is for Deborah, since you are sort of a founder of it and you've been here, I think, you know, one of the longest. So can you describe what you think are like the specific characteristics of the Bushwick art scene? Like, we're making history. What history has been made specifically? Maybe talking about the scene in the beginning and how the scene has changed now. Just in terms of who the artists are and what their contributions are to this sort of alternative art history.
Well, I've been around, as Loren has, long enough to have seen artists do other kinds of scenes, like the East Village scene where artists ran a lot of the early galleries. But I think those were really about elevating certain people, like Jeff Koons,
right,
to great commercial success. I don't think anyone who started those galleries was about community, transparency, non-hierarchical structures. They were about, like, commerce. But I think this scene was not. I think part of it was that there were a lot of the initial players were not artists even. They were, like Laura Braslow, community activists. And they were really more interested in making an everyone can play playing field. The first Bushwick Open Studios was a very simple affair, and it was anybody can participate and curate your own spaces. And so I think that the early artist-run galleries were, they tried to have quality, but they were trying to throw off the trappings of the elitist structures that had shackled us when we were in Manhattan. So it was pure. I don't know how to say it. Maybe I'm deluding myself. We tried to be special and curate things that were of quality, but we tried to be welcoming. And it provided a lot of toeholds for artists just coming into the community to get a place to show, because as these artist-run spaces expanded and more people ran them, there were more entries into the system. And I think that's what was so exciting about it. And they took place in a variety of settings, in people's basements and
part of their studios and in the storefront, which I rented. And it was just like they were woven into the fabric of the community too. And so that made them, as Lisa was saying, like part of a scene in the community. And so it was, I don't know, I thought it was really special.
There was no resume prerequisite for showing.
Yeah,
it
so the professionalizations of artists and the whole like MFA from Columbia University.
No,
and so
not a part of it.
And so that was mentioned before, like the more recent sort of generations of artists here. Maybe that's what distinguishes the scene now. So you might have sort of like it broken down into scenes like these are the risky kids and they do these spaces and these are so and so. Is that like we see? It's like a sort
of generational
thing.
What turned me off was some, and I'm going to get on a horse here.
Thank
is
you.
Some of
that
the recent galleries that have opened that are run by artists that are really nice and spiffy and much better renovated than anything that I ever did, casting aspersions on those of us who started it by saying things like, we got out here, the kinds of galleries that we were operating were really just not very ambitious, and they just showed their friends, and they were, and I read this stuff, and it was a huge turnoff, and really made me want to quit.
Where did you read that?
I will tell you later. And these are spaces that are really great, and they're definitely
like
the next
said,
incarnation.
You've got nothing good
like,
to say, come sit by me.
Something about me running those like sort of tawdry spaces where, you know, less maybe spiffy-looking things were happening and less capitalized things were happening, but we made it safe for you to come out here and do your thing. So it's, I don't know.
Okay, we have to go back.
Lauren?
The scene's changed. Did you have a question back? No? Okay.
I just want to say every place kind of has its own flavor, and New York, because it's so concentrated in terms of population, feels like there are these artist communities. But, you know, I moved here from San Francisco, and you want to talk about gentrification.
Yeah.
Like, there is practically no working class neighborhood in San Francisco anymore. I mean, I came before, I grew up there. I was
born
there.
The Mission District is just disastrous.
I know. I used to live in the Mission, and whenever I visit, because my dad still lives in San Francisco, it's heartbreaking. I mean, I just cannot believe whole neighborhoods have changed, and they're now like tech, you know, Google bus drivers. And it's like I say, every place is a little bit different because there's so many people here, but I think that this gentrification issue is not, you know, particular to New York. And I think it really comes down to, someone has a t-shirt saying, because capitalism. And that really is it. I think that like some of us who are a little more progressive minded, you know, are trying to find a balance just kind of conceptually or ethically between capitalism and, for want of a better term, socialism. You know, like we want more of a social safety net. We want social security. But, you know, all of that stuff. But our country is so polarized now. There's such an income inequality that we're just getting farther and farther. I mean, I don't think we can take this Bushwick artist community thing separately from what's happening in the country and in the world. I think globalism and population growth. I mean, if the population didn't keep exploding, we wouldn't be running out of neighborhoods, you know, because how many more places in New York can artists move into? There's not that many more. I mean, okay, Cypress Hills, Staten Island, I mean, there are some, but you keep pushing farther out.
But this is what's the problem, is that we need New York City. I mean, the whole country is available. There's a middle of the country that's been totally hollowed out. They would love, I'm sure, for artists to move to Allentown and suburbs of Pittsburgh and places like that, but artists don't want to live there. They want to live where they can make a living. I mean, everybody in this room probably is involved in some way in the broader economy that kicks off jobs, and that's true of San Francisco. I mean, but there's places between here and San Francisco, but artists don't want to live there either.
Yeah, I don't.
I mean,
they
all want to be here. And that's
okay.
Just,
okay. Back, yeah.
Pragmatic.
We can't hear you.
From a pragmatic point of view, communities are organic and they change. And there really is very little ways to stop real estate money and gentrification. But one thing I've noticed in my sitting here this last month is the division between artists and the people that lived here before the artists and are being displaced by them. To me, as a pragmatic person, you
think one good example, we probably should be wrapping up at some point pretty soon, is this book. Now, Sibylla did a fantastic job. She had a lot of people. Ms. Fabricant designed it. A lot of people giving a lot of effort to this book. She talked about, and Deborah was a part of it, how the Bushwick Open Studios started out in a certain way, and eventually they started to have a little fundraiser, and they started to make a little money, mostly from selling beer that they'd been somebody donated, and they made a couple thousand here and a couple thousand there. But as time goes by and people sort of get this focus of like, okay, what do we need? Well, we need to make some money somehow. People's creativity comes together and they start putting a little bit of money here, a little bit. So the next iteration of the Bushwick Open Studios, okay, they raise a little bit more money. They get $8,000. It's like, well, we can use that to start doing this and we can start doing that. A little bit more time goes by and then it's like, gee, we were able to raise $32,000. So, and then they were able to do the book. Okay, if you would extrapolate that out to people that were actually thinking about going and getting into real estate, and then you start to get involved with the community and all these other things where you're actually, and this goes to what you're saying, you're getting into a piece of the action, but in a capitalist form of way. So you're not hoping that somebody's gonna come along. This is the thing I feel about socialism. I don't wanna sit back and wait for the government to like solve my problems, because the government's not gonna be there. It's never gonna be there. You're gonna have to get out there and be yourself, but you're gonna have to be like Sibylla and these other people, which means that's all you freaking do for you. George McCunis, who was a genius and started Fluxus, he, for the last 10 years of his life, he stopped. All he was doing was dealing with the real estate thing, and he had the Attorney General of the state of New York on his ass. He actually was hiding in a bunker. They had a museum exhibition, and he had like blades on the doors because he was afraid that the cops were gonna come through there and arrest him because he had some shady paperwork going to get these buildings bought and the financing and all this other stuff. But what I'm saying is, if you take this book as an example, you start out with $2,000 for beer, and eventually you're getting up to where you're talking about, not real money, but pretty, you know, little lump of money. If you extend that out, but it's like, well, we're gonna do this to buy a piece of real estate or to do something, you could do it. And then you would be in charge of your own futures. You wouldn't be relying on the government. You wouldn't be relying on the developers or the hipsters coming out of the Ivy League. You would sort of take charge of yourself. And that, if I had one thing to say, that would be my hope, that maybe part of what happens out of Bushwick is that maybe artists have finally figured out how they can sort of take charge of their own careers, their own lives, but it's a lot of work.
Last question, and then we're gonna wrap up. You had one. You just covered it.
Yeah, we were dealing with like self-sufficiency by, we have all these creative people here, and maybe we're all not rich or come from Ivy League backgrounds, but how come we don't own property? How come we never aspire to own? We come with the idea of like, I hope this place is cheap for 2 years, and then I hope the next place is cheap for 2 years. We migrate too fast instead of just saying, why don't we just own a block? You know, like, how, you know, it's not sexy, but look what happened with Little Italy. Chinatown was like, we're going to buy this.
It was gonna slip in one more quickly.
Yeah, I just want to say there's a real estate investment collective or cooperative,
yes.
That has a meeting coming up at the end of the month. I think it's the 23rd, but look it up. Real estate investment cooperative. It's run by a couple of artists. I don't know that they're specifically Bushwick, but they're New York based artists.
And there was like a conference, a Stay in New York conference. And they were speaking.
I just wanted to say that I actually know where that worked, because my brother-in-laws live in Emeryville, which is right outside of San Francisco. It's between Berkeley and
Yeah,
that's what you just said. Yeah, near Berkeley. But anyway, and you have to deal with the city. I mean, it's not. You gather as artists, you go to community board meetings, and they bought real estate. I mean, they have an artist. They had it now for, I don't know, over 20 years. But they did it as a group. They did it with the city.
Well, I would like to end this on a
positive note. That's true. I think so.
I think that, you know, when I watch my students and I see the community they start in graduate school to support and help and think and talk, and I think when people move out, these kinds of communities start. And we have agency. No one can sell work if we don't make it, you know, and we can control what we make and how we want to live. And I think we should just work really hard to do that. And I think that I'm so happy, again, that Sibeli has figured out how to at least document this moment in time with this wonderful book. And, you know, and I think that's part of owning the work that we do, is to just make sure that someone sees it and it stays visible. So thank you all for coming.